This video was sponsored by LastPass. Hey there, welcome to Life Noggin. Getting sick is the absolute worst, but it's just a part of being, well, alive. On Earth, every living organism has at least one virus that can infect it, from plants and animals to bacteria and single-celled archaea. But what about non-living things? You've probably heard that viruses aren't technically alive, so can a virus catch another virus? Before we get into the nitty-gritty, I wanted to thank LastPass who sponsored this video. LastPass eliminates the struggle of having to look for all your passwords, and relieves the anxiety around getting locked out of your accounts. Because LastPass is your own personal password manager and remembers everything for you, you'll no longer need to write or reset your password. And don't worry, all your passwords are encrypted, so only you can see them. LastPass will even autofill passwords automatically when visiting Android or iOS apps and mobile sites, so logging in is seamless and you can get to the things you love quicker. Since downloading LastPass, I've had so much extra time to focus on the things that actually matter, like beating all my friends at trivia games. LastPass lets you keep track of all your passwords easily, so you can stay stress-free. Put your passwords on autopilot with LastPass. Click the link below to find out more and try LastPass today. And now, back to the episode. So, can a virus catch another virus? Well, until recently, the answer was no. Viruses are simple, submicroscopic parasites, 100 times smaller than bacteria. Without a metabolism or proteins for transcription and replication, they're little more than zombies borrowing life from other creatures. So if viruses can't even keep themselves alive, how can they sustain another? Nature, it seems, is always surprising us. In the early 2000s, scientists discovered an exceptional virus that altered our understanding of life itself. At first, experts assumed it was bacteria, but what they actually found was a giant virus, so large that it could be glimpsed with a simple microscope. Inside, the virus had many more genes than normal, encoding for proteins, metabolic pathways, even replication machinery. Experts named it the mimivirus, short for mimicking microbe, and soon they began to find others just like it. That's when things got really meta, because while the mimivirus was a surprise, the discovery of its relative, the so-called mama virus, was a bombshell. Slightly larger than the Mimi, the Mama virus turned out to be hiding an itsy-bitsy virus of its own. With just 21 genes, this little fella named Sputnik is the first example of a virus infecting an amoeba. Since then, dozens of other virophages have been found, and while there's still a lot we don't know about this madness, the basics are familiar. After infecting its first host, Sputnik releases its DNA into the amoeba. Unable to reproduce on its own, it then attaches to an already present mama virus, injecting its genetic material into that second host too. Once inside, this foreign DNA hijacks the host's viral factory, so it could begin to replicate, ultimately making it harder for the mama virus to do the same. It's David and Goliath on a minuscule scale. Today, we know virophages can infect both mama and mimi viruses, as well as plenty of others. As such, some consider them viral parasites, representing a whole new class of virus, while others think that they are too basic to be called even that. Whatever they are, they're probably important, and we keep learning more and more about virophages and giant viruses. In fact, just last year, a paper was published stating that some giant viruses, called Pandora viruses, are so large they can encode thousands of proteins, 90% of which are not seen anywhere else on Earth. Plus, not only do giant viruses appear to create genes, they also appear to steal them. Sputnik and other virophages have remarkably similar genes to their hosts, which has experts wondering if these giant viruses are defending themselves by stealing genetic material from their viral parasites. All that is still up for debate, but the idea that viruses can create and transfer genes does fit well with another theory. More than 1 billion years ago, a giant DNA-based virus is thought to have infected a budding eukaryotic cell, somehow creating the first cell nucleus. Like I said, nature is full of surprises. Sometimes they're scary surprises, but still. So are there any questions about the body that you have for us? Let me know now in the comment section below, and your question could become a future video. As always, my name is Blocko. This has been Life Noggin. Don't forget to keep on thinking.